this morning. Let's give him the glory, for he is worthy to be praised. Amen.
Good and your mercy.
Why I praise you, I lift you up.
because my mind wasn't there. And I knew that at any moment I could snap. And I knew what snapping meant for me. That I would hurt myself or hurt somebody else. But glory be to God. Right as I was looking through that phone book, the phone rang. And my heart was on the other line. I don't even think I told Erica this story. But she was on the other line.
And you will find the book of Acts in the New Testament, and it is right after the Gospels. So when you turn to the New Testament, you got Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Right after John, you will find Acts. Who wrote the book of Acts? Yes! Good old Luke wrote the book of Acts. This is kind of a continuation to his gospel in a sense. It's a different genre, but he kind of continues the story of Jesus through the book of Acts, and he turns it into, of course, the story of the apostles. In fact, the reason it's called Acts is because the book is titled The Acts of the Apostles. And so we followed in the book of the Gospel of Luke, the life of Jesus. And then in the very beginning of Acts, we got a little bit of the final ending of Jesus' ministry on earth. And then we moved directly into the Acts of the Apostles and the things that they did through the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. So Acts 5:33-42. I'm going to read it. It says, when they heard this, they were furious and wanted to put them to death. But a Pharisee named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law who was honored by all the people, stood up in the Sanhedrin and ordered that the men be put outside for a little while. Then he addressed the Sanhedrin, men of Israel, consider carefully what you intend to do to these men. Some time ago, Thaddeus appeared claiming to be somebody, and about 400 men rallied to him. He was killed, all his followers were dispersed, and it all came to nothing. After him, Judas the Galilean appeared in the days of the census and led a band of people in revolt. He too was killed, and all his followers were scattered. Therefore, in the present case, I advise you, leave these men alone. Let them go. For if their purpose or activity is of human origin, it will fail. But if it is from God, you will not be able to stop these men. You will only find yourselves fighting against God. Verse 40 says, his speech persuaded them. They called the apostles in and had them flogged. Then they ordered them not to speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. Verse 41, the apostles left the Sanhedrin rejoicing because they had been counted worthy of suffering disgrace for the name. Day after day in the temple courts and from house to house, they never stopped teaching and proclaiming the good news that Jesus is the Messiah. May God add a blessing to the reading of his word. You may have your seats. Now, I came in right here because this is the meat of what I want to go over, but I do want to catch everyone up just in case you're not familiar with this story. We find if we would have started a little bit further up, we've come in where the disciples are standing before the Sanhedrin addressing the high priest at this point. Okay, what is the Sanhedrin? The Sanhedrin made up kind of the elite Jews of the time. I would kind of make it like the Senate today. The Senate and maybe the House of Representatives. Like that would be the Sanhedrin. They were the lawmakers or the law enforcers rather. They were the ones that were the richest. They had the most money. They were the ones that were influential. They were the ones that were the studied people. They went to college. They knew how to read or what we would equate as college. They knew how to read. They were the ones that interpreted the law of Moses and the Torah. And so they were held to very, very high esteem. Well, you find that the disciples, the ones that Jesus left behind, told, go ye therefore and preach, that this is right after Acts 2 has happened. The Holy Spirit fell, and they are just so, I mean, boy, they got the power now. So they bold. They're standing in the temple court. Again, this is like we go to Washington, D.C. So this is like the center of influence here. They're standing in the temple court preaching Jesus. The guy that they just killed, not 40-some days, or a little bit over 40 days ago, they're now preaching him in front of everybody that killed him. So here we are, here's the disciples, and they're preaching Jesus. And they were questioned as to, hey, didn't we arrest y'all? Because they got arrested, so you're not allowed to preach Jesus. Everybody kind of knows at that point in time, you were persecuted for preaching Jesus. Say the name of Jesus, we're going to arrest you. They were arrested, they were taken to jail, and then they were let loose from jail by an angel. The Bible says that an angel came and freed them. They didn't leave though. These jokers, boy, I love the boldness of the apostles back then. Boy, they came straight out of jail, went straight back to the answer to God, not man. And we saw Jesus die on a cross. You killed him. And then we saw him get up and rise from the dead. The Holy Spirit has come to us and empowered us now to preach this truth. And we will not stop no matter what. You can kill us. You can throw us in prison. You can hit us. You can try your best to stop us, but we ain't shutting up about this one.
All right.
And so we find now, and this is where we came in, it said that after they heard this, that's what they had said, that's what the this is, basically they told them off. They were furious and wanted to put him to death. Just like they did Jesus so many times ago. You know, every time Jesus would speak up, we learned about this in Sunday school. Every time Jesus would speak up and talk about who he was, one of the first things they would want to do is they picked up some rocks to stone him. They wanted to kill him, and so on and so. The apostles had it the same. And so we come in right here. And right there it says, I want y'all to look at this for a second. I'm going to show you something. It says that there's a guy, a man, came in and stopped the Sanhedrin, stopped the high priest. His name was Gamaliel. I want you to remember that name, Gamaliel. Because the Bible doesn't just throw names in just because. It just doesn't do that. We've talked about this before. It doesn't throw colors in for no reason. It doesn't throw, it's not a descriptive book. Not like how our novels are today, where you'll describe everything. And the wind was softly blowing, and the trees rustled in the background. The Bible doesn't do, if you've ever read through it, you don't find that descriptive terminology in the Bible. It's very straightforward, and what's in there for a purpose. You will never come across a number, a gemstone, a color, a name that just has no purpose whatsoever. If it's there, it's important. And so I want to stop here for a second. I want you to pay attention to this man, Gamaliel. There's a reason his name is mentioned specifically. And if you were a Jew living in the first century, you would have immediately recognized this name. And you would have known everything that was associated with his name. It's kind of like the name in the entertainment industry, Jackson. When you hear the name Jackson, you automatically think, if you're thinking music, you're thinking Janet Jackson, Michael Jackson. You might even go back to the Jackson 5. You know, you might think Tito and Jermaine and all of them, you know. You automatically think, and you automatically give a little bit of respect and prestige to those that claim and to take claim to the name Jackson. And one of the first things we want to know is, can you sing? Can you dance? You know, because that's what we know them for. They're entertainers. And so the name Jackson has come to have a lot of respect here in America and all over the world, for that matter. The name Jackson is known because Michael Jackson was known worldwide. Yeah. Well, one of the most, of our time, one of the most famous singers to ever live, really.
That's right.
And so his legacy far precedes even America, but it goes all into all the nations. And so we find that this name, Gamaliel, is one of those type of names. And here's why. How many people have ever come to one of our Seder dinners? A lot of people. Every year we have what's called a Seder dinner. It is a representation of what happened when the Israelites were released from captivity in Egypt through the Exodus. The Jews, and Jesus would have been included, would celebrate this every single year. Because Jesus was Jewish, and I won't go into a whole Seder teaching, but because he was Jewish, he instituted what's called communion, or the Last Supper, during the Passover Seder meal. And so what we do every year is we do a Passover Seder meal and also take Holy Communion at that time in the exact manner that Jesus, or as close as we can, get to the exact manner that Jesus would have done it. And so, just like the Jews, we prepare a meal and we go through all of the different sections of the Seder. Well, you will know, and when I say this, some of you will recognize, during a certain part of the ceremony, we eat something called a Hillel sandwich. Does everybody that's been to the Seder recognize the Hillel sandwich? Because it's gross, right?
Yeah.
It don't really taste all that good. I'm not going to lie to you. It's not something that you really would just make at home because it tastes good. But it's part of the ceremony. It's basically some harset, which is a nut mixture with some bitter herbs, which we use horseradish between two pieces of matzah. And so it ain't that tasty, but and so we take it because it's part of the ceremony. And it was started by a guy by the name of Hillel. Rabbi Hillel. And this is not an agape tradition. This is a Jewish tradition. Rabbi Hillel was born in about 110 BC. So 110 years before Christ, basically. He died around AD 10. So Jesus was actually alive. And Hillel was actually alive during the birth of Christ. And so he was alive when Jesus was born and so on and so forth. And he became one of the most highly respected and important Jewish figures. In fact, when you hear me talk about the Talmud, anybody ever heard me talk about the Talmud? It's the Jewish book, it's not a religious book per se, but it is the Jewish book that really confirms Jesus because of the fact that it is a Jewish secular book, it's like a history book. They've written down pretty much everything that happened, and Jesus is mentioned in the Talmud as being a troublemaker. But he was one of the guys that was it developed the Talmud. And if anyone knows anything about Jewish culture, you might recognize the name the Mishra. The Mishra is also it's more of a religious book, but it was also developed by this rabbi, Rabbi Hillel. So he is one of the most influential and one of the most important Jewish figures of his time. So Rabbi Hillel happens to be the grandfather of this guy, Gamaliel. So when Gamaliel stands up and he stands up for the disciples, in essence, he is carrying with him. It's almost like I got up here in some praise and worship, right? And one of the Jacksons stood up. Paris happened to be in the audience. And she stood up. And all y'all laughing because I messed up the words on one of them songs. And she stood up and said, stop laughing at her. Don't laugh. She messed up the words. My dad did it a whole lot. And y'all never knew it. Y'all never laughed at him. So if she would stand up for me, that would probably make most of us shut up. Because at that point, it's like, oh, Mike did it. All right, cool. Well, Gamaliel brought in his rabbi, his grandfather's authority. They respected him because of who his grandfather was. Well, why are you telling me, Pastor? Why is that really important? Well, the thing is, the Bible tells us that if we are, it says in Proverbs 3:3-4, it says, let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck, write them on the tablet of your heart. Then you will win favor and a good name in the sight of God and man. So in other words, when you live your life above reproach, you will find favor in unexpected places. And so basically that's what happened to the disciples. The disciples were despised, however they found favor in Gamaliel, which was one of the most important figures of his time. He was very highly respected because of the family line that he came through, and they received favor. How can I apply that to my life? The thing is, too often in today's society, we only act righteous and we only act right when we see a benefit attached to acting right. We go above and beyond only when going above and beyond is going to pay us more or get us something. The Word of God tells us in Colossians 3:22-24, it says, slaves, obey your earthly masters in everything, and do it not only when their eye is on you, but to curry their favor, but with a sincere heart and reverence for the Lord. Whatever you do, make it, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters. Since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward, it is the Lord Christ you are serving. God is not pleased with us when we half step.
That's it.
Oh, we'll talk about it for a little while here. We should be putting our best foot forward at all times. So no, God is not pleased when we milk the time clock at work.
All right. Come on now.
See, you got a little bit quiet. God is not pleased when we show up late and leave early.
Come on now.
God is not pleased when we do just the bare minimum on our jobs because we get paid bare minimum wage. See, the thing is, you got to treat a minimum wage job the same way you would treat a higher paid job. Because the problem, the thing is, if you are faithful in little, God will bless you with much. And so the way you act on that minimum wage job is basically showing somebody, if it ain't nobody but God himself, how you gonna act when you get to the higher paid job. Because if you can't do right here, what makes me think you can do right there? He's not pleased when we step over trash on the job because it's just not our responsibility to pick it up. And it's not in my job description. So we'll step over trash at the janitor's job. Tissues and everything else, we just let them be on the floor, paper and everything. And we don't care because we don't have the excellence standard that we are working for God and not man. What would happen if we really worked that way? When you went on your job tomorrow morning thinking, God, for X company, I am working for you. What would your job look like? What would your work ethic look like if you did that tomorrow? See, the difference would be some of us would have a difference in the way that we came in. We wouldn't just stand at the house talking about, well, I got time because I am giving them 2-3 minutes more of what they owe me because they ain't paying me to get their 5 minutes here. I'm going to get there right when the bell tone. I'm going to clock in right when it. That they're gonna be traffic when I get ready to come back. I already know that the line is long, so I'm just gonna go ahead and just let y'all know. Cause we tell our friends don't expect me when the time clock is 11:30. Just expect me a little bit closer to 12. I already know there's traffic. And we'll leave out and take our time, won't we? But if we were working for God, wouldn't we bring a sandwich from home? Wouldn't we sit there right at the desk? Cause we don't wanna disappoint God. We don't even wanna get real. We don't want an excuse where God will look at us and say, what's going on? Why were you late? And boy, would we get mad. Boy, I'm talking to myself here too. Boy, I know when I was in the Marine Corps, yeah, you know, boy, I would do just this. Boy, they would tell us, okay, you're leaving at such and such a time, 4:00. And boy, I would be so excited to be leaving at 4:00. And I'm like, yeah, 4:00, can't get here soon enough. It would never fail that 3:30 would come along and they got about 10 jobs for me to do. And I would complain. What you mean it's 3:30 and y'all have 10 jobs for me to do? I'm supposed to be leaving at 4:00. Now, mind you, the real time to leave is 5:00. So I'm already leaving an hour early anyway, but I want my whole hour to get on the road. And so I'm looking at 3:30 like, y'all about to keep me till 5:00 for real, aren't you? But I would complain about it. But what if I was doing that for God? Because I tell you what, if I'm standing here and I'm worshiping God, God can tell me all day long, you need to stay in worship for about an hour or two more. And I'm happy to do it. I don't know about you, but thank you, God, for the ability to worship. So I'm happy to stay in worship an hour or two longer. I'm happy to do the work for God. But when it came to man, when it came to them, when it came to the woman, say? What would our days look like if we knew that God was the boss and he would be inspecting our behavior at the end of the day? What would our work ethic really be like? In the past 2 or 3 years, I was thinking about this in the car a couple days ago. I have been invited to travel and speak at several venues. I really thank God for the opportunity. This is stuff that I like to do. And whenever I travel, not really when I'm around Savannah because it's so close, but whenever I travel, I'm paid to do that. It's a paid job. I'm given accommodations, I'm given a stipend, they pay for my travel to get to these places. And all of the speaking engagements that I've been on in the past couple of years, they have come with little help from marketing or promotion. So in other words, you don't really see my marketing video, book Pastor Candace for this, that, and the other. Like, we don't really do that. Really what happens is people see something that I've done for free and like it and end up inquiring whether or not I would be interested to come to their location and deliver something similar. And if I actually promoted and marketed myself as a motivational speaker, and if I developed a platform and all that kind of stuff, I could bid for jobs, and I probably could make, providing that they hired me, a substantial amount of money. Motivational speakers make money. The reason I don't do this is because at this point in my life and the development of this church, God has not released me to take on such an endeavor. That's just the bottom line of it. The Bible says to seek ye first the kingdom and all of his righteousness, and I will add all of these things will be added unto you. And so I'm building God's house first. That's what King Solomon did. I take that very seriously. Before I build my own, I build God's. So as I mentioned, I get paid to travel and speak sometimes, and the reason I've gotten these jobs, for lack of a better term, is because at the beginning of my career, I did a lot of pro bono work. And so in other words, I spoke for free. And the thing is, and you can go through the videos, I have videos all over YouTube, I never gave the pro bono work any less of me than I give to the guys paying money for me to come. The same Candace that stood on Johnson Square many years ago is the same Candace that stood on stage at the Reformation Project. The same Candace that stands here every Sunday is the same Candace that went to the Vision Church in Atlanta and preached from that pulpit. I didn't change me. I didn't give more of me. I didn't become more animated or give them or study a little bit more because it's them. I give them the same that I give you. And the same Candace that will stand before millions eventually, because I just believe God for what he said, and thousands will be the same Candace that stands here right now. And I don't take that to say that I am so good, but what I say is that when you give your all, even on the small things, God will then bless you with more. And because I gave my all for free in Johnson Square in the heat, and because I gave my all for free over there in XYZ. The thing is, and what am I trying to say? I'm trying to say, and you can take this into your own opportunity, I'm trying to say this, that take this to your office tomorrow, to your own profession. You don't know who's watching you or who may pass through and see you. Don't give anyone an opportunity to see you at your worst. You got to always give people an opportunity to see you at your best. I don't care if you're working for free. Break. I don't care if you're just walking in the building or you're leaving out in the end of the day. You got to be pristine and excellent.
She always gonna make it. You don't know. You don't know. And so the thing is, you have to act as if you are already getting paid the six-figure job, even when you're getting paid minimum wage, because you'll never get to six figures with a minimum wage mentality. You got to be on minimum wage job with a six-figure mentality, because that's how you get there.
Come on.
Amen.
Somebody not hear me today. I don't care if you are a pooper scooper. You got to come to work clean, neat, and ironed. You got to get to work on time. You have to go the extra mile. You have to be a good steward over your position. And watch God give you the desires of your heart. But see, often we act funny when it comes to what we consider menial work. Why should I be clean? I'm just going to get dirty anyhow. Why should I show up on time? They don't care. Don't nobody ever say nothing to me when I leave early, so I'm gonna do it. It all boils down to who you are inside. But let me tell you something. Anybody remember the movie Coming to America?
Yes.
Y'all remember when Prince Hakeem, he went and got a job at McDonald's?
Yes.
Y'all ain't saved. Y'all didn't see that movie. He's like, you ain't saved even. I saw it a long time ago. Any case, I love that movie. Any case, he sees Lisa on stage, so he decides to go and get a job. And he's never worked a day in his life, right? And so, matter of fact, y'all remember the opening scene when he was waking up. They did everything for him, right? Bathed him and everything. And so he has never worked a day in his life. However, he's royalty. And see, royalty carries himself a little bit different than everybody else. See, somebody know where I'm going with this already. And so, Prince Hakeem, he took a job at McDowell's and not McDonald's. See, they got the golden arches. They got the golden arches. And so, in any case, they went and he took a job over there. And there's a scene where Lisa compliments him on his work ethic. And she says, there's something different about you, because the way you even sweep the floor and take out the trash is different than anybody else here. See, the thing is, you are King's kid. Those of us that are sitting in this room, our Father is the Most High God. So there should be something different about the work ethic that we portray when we go on the job, because of the royalty that's inside of us. See, you can't hide royalty for long. He tried to do it. He tried to fit in and just be regular old him. He tried to, but he couldn't. There should be something inside of you, that royal person inside of you, that queen or that king, that prince or that princess should rise up. They won't let you do things half behind it. Won't let you just step over trash. Won't let you get to work late. Won't let you not have good work ethic, because the royalty in me is better than that. Who I am and who my Father is better than that. There should be something different about you. We should have favor. And I know that the statement, favor ain't fair, but there is favor that is well deserved.
Come on.
See, there's two types of favor. Some favor you just get because, but then there's favor that you earn. And we should be earning favor left and right, because we should stand a head above everyone else. As short as I am, 5'1", I should stand out when I'm in a crowd, because I should hold my head just a little bit higher because of who my daddy is.
Yeah.
See, I should stand out by the work ethic that I portray. I should stand out because I'm proud of who I am. It's all about who I am. It's not about the job that I do. And so whether I or whether I'm typing, or whether I'm speaking, or whether I'm a surgeon, or whether I'm a lawyer, or whether I'm a doctor, or whether I'm in the Senate, or whether I'm the President of the United States of America, shouldn't be no different in my difference in my work ethic. I should be the same person up here that I was when I was working for Arby's, so that I am preaching behind somebody's pulpit. Because if I couldn't have work ethic there, what made God think I'm going to have work ethic here? And so we'll go back to the story. The disciples received favor from Gamaliel. he stands up for them and he basically says, leave them alone. If they're fake, they'll fizzle off just like the ones before them. But if they're real, there's nothing we can do to stop them anyhow. We will find ourselves fighting against God if we try. Of course, I paraphrase that. I love the fact that Bible study always lines up somehow or another. We just talked about, Sunday school rather, just talked about this verse in Sunday school. When we first opened the doors of Agape, this is the scripture that God gave to me. He said, don't worry about what people say about you, because you're doing my work. And he basically said, they won't be able to stop what I have put forward. They can try, but they won't be able to stop it. That's why I don't really get too scared when it comes. I don't worry all that often. I have concerns sometimes, but I don't worry all that often, because those that would rise up against us, they will always falter and fail. Because in essence, they are rising up not against us, they are rising up against God. They can fight that battle if they want. But I do want to take a moment, because I believe it is necessary at times, and how many people know that the enemy is listening at all times. So I want to take a moment real quick, because it does get frustrating when I see the discouragers rise up to be distractions, to cause dissension, to create confusion. So today, let it be publicly known, Agape Empowerment Ministries, everything that we do and everything that we will do is under direction and the lead of the Spirit of God Himself. Amen. Therefore, when you talk against us, when you doubt it, when you try and stop it, when you despise it, when you make plans to destroy it, when you are fighting against it, you are fighting against God Himself. Yeah, I'm here to serve notice to the enemy today. It's not just fancy words at the end of a sentence when you say that Jesus Christ is the King of Kings. Church you go to is right. with God. That's basically what the disciples said.
Yes.
That's what Gamaliel said when he said, if y'all don't like what they're doing, take it up with God.
Yes. That's all right.
When it comes to this church,
that's all right.
When it comes to your life, and you know God is leading you,
right.
Who you think you are trying to be a leader,
take it up
with God.
Right.
Who you think you are going through discipleship, take it up with God.
Yes.
Huh? You think you're going to teach somebody else, take it up with God.
Yes. Yes.
Because in essence, if God is leading you to it, he will surely bring you through.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
It's not by your own will that you are doing. The Bible says that the steps of the righteous are ordered by God. And if you are listening for the voice of God, if you really are allowing his word to be a light to your path, and you are taking every step. I love it when we pray about everything that we do. We don't move till God says move.
That's it.
Because we can be assured at that point that we will never misstep.
Yes.
Now, I'm not saying that everywhere God will take you will be easy.
Right.
Says it right there in the scripture. It says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death.
That's right.
See, that ain't an easy walk right there. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the valley of the shadow of death. That's a real place.
Yeah.
And when David wrote that, obviously there was a reason he needed to go from where he was through the valley of the shadow of death to get to a specific destination. There was no option for David to go around. He had to go through.
Yes.
So when we say, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, it's not saying that I'm never going to go through anything. It's saying sometimes you have to go through things.
Yes.
But be encouraged by the next part.
All right.
Because then it also says, I will fear no evil.
Yes.
For thou art with me.
Yes.
Thy rod and thy staff,
yes,
they comfort me.
Yes.
Come on.
The rod and the staff of God.
Yes.
Two very distinct instruments used by the shepherd.
Yes.
One, the rod. More like a billy club or a nightstick.
Right.
You really want to put it into nowadays terminology. The rod was used as a rod of correction and protection. Whenever an animal, a wolf or a bear or a lion would want to come and steal one of the sheep or harm one of the shepherd then would take the rod and begin to beat off the threat. You can be comforted in knowing that as you travel through life's valley of the shadow of death, that God has his rod of protection waiting and willing to protect you against everything and any threat that would ever come your way.
Yes.
It says, thy staff. The staff is what we see most common. It has a hook at the top. That's used for is when a sheep begins to stray from the rest of the pack. That shepherd will then take that hook and grab it by its neck and lead it back to safety. Sheep are very good at finding their way into small crevices and not being able to find their way out. Likewise, a shepherd may find a sheep stuck between a rock and a hard place, literally. And that shepherd can't reach that sheep with their bare hands. They've gone too far. But that shepherd can take that staff, reach out, and pull that poor little sheep back to pasture. You can be comforted in knowing that you are never too far for God's staff to reach you. That his rod and his staff, they will protect you.
Yes.
as we travel this road, this valley of the shadow of death, know that He is leading you to a place of refuge. A place where it says that He leads me beside the still waters. My cup runneth over. He is leading you to a place where there is no danger. No danger, still waters. Anybody ever been in the country and been next to still waters? Where everything around you is just quiet and serene and calm. Still waters, when you look into still waters, you can see life. I'm not talking stagnant water, because stagnant water is different. It's more of just a pond that's just been sitting there, and that's murky and that's gross. But still waters, it says to me that at one point in time, because we are considering it still, at one point in time it was moving. See, and when water moves, it cleanses itself, and that's fresh water. It's water that has life in it. But then at certain points of the day, and it's depending on weather, rough waters come and still. The Bible says that He's leading you beside the still waters, those rough areas in your life.
Yes.
Those areas in your life that have been tumultuous. Those areas that have tossed you from the left and to the right. Those areas will eventually be still. Your cup runneth over. Your cup, meaning you will have more than enough. Later in that scripture, it also talks about the fact that it will make your enemies your footstool. Because it says that He will prepare a table for you in the presence of your enemies.
Yes.
Meaning that you should not look to your left and to your right and despise what you see. Because in order for your table to be prepared, in order for your cup to run over, the enemies should be present. If they're not there, then God can't show Himself to be God. Who is He showing Himself to? He's got to show Himself to those naysayers that have been saying that you could not or would not. The enemies are essential to your overflow. You can rest assured that your God has you, that you are in His safety, that you are protected by Him. You can rest assured. You can know that you know, that you know, that your God loves you. He has not left you, nor will He ever leave you or forsake you.